Please stick around so you can meet new people in the chat, or please join us in the hospitality room where you can get connected and find out more about us. I do have a few announcements about upcoming events that I want to highlight. First of all, the potluck that was scheduled for July 9th has been canceled. You'll remember it was a celebration of Jean and Robert Crumb's 50th wedding anniversary. Can I hear a huzzah? But we can have our cake and eat it too. Even though that potluck has been canceled, there will be cake served in the hospitality room next week. Now, in 3 Sundays, so this Sunday, the 9th, and then the 16th, join the Woito family for a Boof potluck from 4:30 to 7:30 right here in the sanctuary. Music and fun. Blake Olson and the Midnight Jazz Cats will be playing, and drinks will be provided. Our fellowship donates 25% of our unpledged plate offering every Sunday to support a local organization whose mission aligns with our social justice ministries. For the month of July, we support our own Pay It Forward Fund. Here to tell us more about this fund is Debbie Foster, member of the Congregational Care Team.
Yes, as Deborah says, this month it is the Pay It Forward Fund, the Reverend Elizabeth Green Pay It Forward Fund, which was created in 2008 to address the need among our own Boise Unitarian Universalist Fellowship community for short-term emergency financial assistance. PIF is the recipient of the Social Justice Outreach Plate offering each year, and this is the month, and is available to support BOOF members and friends through the generosity of those who donate. Over the years, funds have helped members and friends stay in their homes, pay for groceries, utilities, medical expenses, and other basic living costs. The generous spirit of this community has always, if you don't know me, I'm a crier, okay, has always been an inspiration for me. Whether, the need is financial, spiritual, assisting with physical tasks of the, or the need for just a hug, one can find support from this community. Okay, given the state of emergency and inflation and economic challenges, we have raised our maximum level of donations to allow for substantive assistance when required. We want to help as many members in need as possible and request your continued generosity and donations for PIP. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Debbie. There are many ways that you can make a financial gift online at our website using the Vanco app or in person using the drop boxes that are just on either sides of the doors. However you choose to give, you can be assured that you are helping our community close at hand. Our minister is the Reverend Sarah LaWall, and she is on summer break. For today's sermon, we welcome fellow congregant and newly elected board vice president, Rob Hamm, into the pulpit. We are also assisted this morning by our tech crew, Samuel Frist and Bill Reed, and of course, Emily Emerson Page, our director of family ministries, and the many volunteers who sign up to greet, make coffee, bring treats, and all of the work in the nursery, all of those tasks that go unmentioned, but I just mentioned them. Coffee this morning is provided by Kathy Sandstrom, and I encourage you to sign up to bring treats and to make coffee for future weeks. As we enter into this time of worship, let's take a moment to breathe together. Fill your body with breath. knowing that our breath connects us to one another, to our bodies, and to our planet. Our breath offers us the opportunity for stillness, to tune in to our spiritual center, to listen deeply to our heart's own longing.
Thou art the song of my heart in the morning. Thou art the truth in my soul. Thou art the dew on the roses adorning. Thou art the woven whole. Thine is the grace to be steadfast in danger. Thine is the peace that none can destroy. Thine is the face of the need-driven stranger. Thine are the wings of joy. Thou art the deep and the deep in me calling. Thou art a lamp where my feet shall tread. Thy way is steep, past perils of falling. Thou art my daily bread. Thine be praise for my spirit uplifted. Thou art the sea of each flowing stream. Thine be the days that are gathered and sifted. Thou art the deathless.
At this hour, in small towns and big cities, in living rooms and ornate sanctuaries, many of our sibling Unitarian Universalists are also lighting chalices, reminding us that we are part of a great community of faith. As we light the chalice here in the sanctuary, for our virtual community, If you have a chalice nearby, you are invited to light it this morning with us and share in the chat where your chalice is lit. We invite a child to light the chalice to recognize that children are our future and to recognize our responsibility to them and the future we are building together. As Safina Eagleston lights the chalice here in the sanctuary, I invite you in our virtual community to light a chalice that you have nearby along with us.
It is my honor to announce our long-time overdue, very first-time chalice lighter, Sofina, who is the eldest and only child of Isla and Eric and the proud pet owner of Buster and Elsa, the dogs. They love to play piano, and if you are a fellow piano player, I encourage you to commiserate and rejoice together with Sofina after the service. Sofina, here are our first-time chalice lighter pin options. Rainbow today. Thank you so much.
Thank you. With our chalices lit in all of our spaces, I offer you this call to worship by the poet Lynn Unger. Breathe. Breathe, said the wind. How can I breathe at a time like this when the air is full of the smoke of burning trees, burning lives? Just breathe, the wind insisted. Easy for you to say if the weight of injustice is not wrapped around your throat, cutting off all air. I need you to breathe. I need you to breathe. Don't tell me to be calm when there are so many reasons to be angry, so much cause for despair. I didn't say to be calm, said the wind. I said to breathe. We're going to need a lot of air to make this hurricane together. Mindful of the connection between our breath and our power, we invite you. Come, let us worship together. As we move into our time for all ages, I'd like to invite the children in the room to come join us in front and watch Jim share today's story.
Lovely, delicious, deep breath. When I take this deep breath with this room, I feel myself drop into my body, and I'm so grateful for that. Our story this morning is The Bell of Justice. It is retold by Faye Morganson, but it is a old story, with one retelling by Mr. Wordsworth himself, in a beautiful poem that I have not read. It begins with a just and caring king. A king in Italy, King Giovanni. The thing he cared most about was ensuring that his land, his people, knew and lived and embodied justice, that fairness was deep in the bones of every part of his kingdom. And so in the name of that, he had built a giant big bell tower. Right in the center of the town was a lovely custom brass bell and a long hemp cord dangling all the way down so that everyone might come and ring this bell. He sent his knights far and wide across the land to tell his people, there is this bell in the center of this town. If anyone needs justice for any reason, come ring this bell. Judges will hear your dispute, your case, and justice will be had. Imagine for a moment with me the sound of that bell. Ringing at first often. If you can imagine all of the disputes that might have built up over the years before this bell had come into existence, whether it was a thief who came visiting, whether it was disagreements among neighbors, whatever it was, justice was heard. Every time this bell was summoned, judges were called. And it became so customary, I don't think that's how you say the word, customary? Okay. It became so common that that the cord was eventually pulled less and less as people lived into these expectations and these examples of justice that were set. The cord eventually became so frayed and worn out over the years that the only thing holding it together at a certain point was one tendril of a vine that crept up and held it in place, connected it to the ground. Way back in the years and years past, as you can imagine, it would take so much time for this core to be worn out. At the time this bell tower was made, there was a knight. He set about engaging his services, offering his skills across the land. I'm going to pause and show you the knight. I have a lot of little props. Little sword there. He became renowned. Him and his horse rode into battle. His years and years grew with him fame and fortune that he was proud of. At the time of this wearing down of the bell, present time for us, he finally retired to an estate up on a grand hill to count his coins. The one thing that he really cared about anymore is money. He spent so much time worried about his wealth, making sure he didn't spend too much of it. He was a stingy man in his old age, that this horse, who had been with him through all these adventures, who was as skilled and as tenacious as he was, he left her to find her own food. He left her to wander the hillside and to hunger. He left her to hunger. Eventually, this hill that she lived on, she ran out of grass. She was old and she was tired. Her skin sagged, her belly ached, and she started to wander away. She wandered days hungry. She finally came across the smell in the wind, a sweet green smell that was, folks, the vine at the bottom of this tower. She arrived here so hungry, she took big bites out of this vine that she didn't notice. With every bite, the tower rang, the bell rang over and over. The people weren't used to hearing this sound. They were curious, they were surprised. The people arrived, the king arrived, the judges arrived. I'm gonna pause and draw all the people. They were kind of astonished to see a very first, as you can imagine, a horse ringing the bell. They were confused, and they finally figured out this horse belongs to that old knight up on the hill. They don't see much of him. They look at this horse, and they realize this horse is hungry. This horse is starved. This horse is not brushed. This horse is not cared for, ringing this bell. It affected all of them. They didn't like it. The knight was summoned, and when he was, he laughed. How could he be accused of a crime for all the work he's put into this kingdom? How could he be called to justice? By the time he arrived at the bell tower in the center of town, he faced a crowd of people for whom he had lost their respect. They're pissed. All right. He was surprised when he was forced to pay a fine, and he was forced to pay for this food and care by a more kind owner. He was forced to pay for all this to make up for the injustice that was done to this horse. The king saw this and had the cord restored with the simple belief that no one is above justice and no person or animal is below it. The bell continues to ring. Let justice ring. In our RE classes today, we're going to deep dive into some core tenets that will help build on us a sense of justice and compassion. And we're going to create some Unitarian Universalist brand prayer beads necklaces. I invite you to join me in blessing our beloved community with song. Thank you all.
Each week, we take time to acknowledge the many joys and sorrows among us and to grieve our many sorrows and losses, so that we might lift the burden for each other and receive the blessings of this community. A reminder that you can submit joys and sorrows in the chat. We combine our collective joys and sorrows every month and share them in a community-wide email. It is through our sharing with one another that we forge the deep bonds of community and connection. Michael and Marcy Barker say it was truly a joy to tour beehives with Dick Knapp and Sarah Cox and taste the honey fresh off the comb. Thank you, Dick and Sarah, for a wonderful experience for the entire family. Trish McCarthy would like you to keep her father in your heart, who's fighting cancer. Dan McCarthy is fighting cancer and other challenges. If you are holding someone in your heart this morning, I invite you to speak their name allowed into this community of love, that we may hold them with you. May the arms of this community hold all our joys and sorrows, those named and those that remain silent, close to our hearts. May we feel the grace that surrounds us be transformed by the spirit of life and love, with warmth to celebrate joys and with gentleness to soothe our aching hearts. Breathe with me. Fill your body with breath. Breathe into this sacred space. Breathe with this beloved community filled with loving kindness. Breathe with wholeheartedness. Listen to what is calling you in the silence.
Let us now hear the wisdom of Buddhist nun Pema Chodron. Times are difficult globally. Awakening is no longer a luxury or an ideal. It's becoming critical. We don't need to add more depression, more discouragement, or more anger to what's already here. It's becoming essential that we learn how to relate sanely with difficult times. The earth seems to be beseeching us to connect with joy and discover our innermost essence. This is the best way that we can benefit others.
More than 2,500 years ago, Siddhartha Gautama, an itinerant holy man and runaway prince, rose from beneath the Bodhi tree after a long period of meditation and contemplation. This man, who would become known as the Buddha, had reached a turning point in his quest to understand the cause of suffering of the world. He had come to understand that the cause of suffering is greed, selfishness, and stupidity. He vowed to devote his life to ending suffering. If Buddhism had a birth, this was it. Siddhartha went on to create a school of thought and a monastic movement dedicated to ending the world's suffering. This movement exists and thrives today. The term the Buddha is a bit of a misnomer. Buddha simply means enlightened or awakened one. Buddhism holds that everybody is capable of Buddha nature, and anyone can become awakened. Although structures and schools exist where people can study and obtain titles and degrees in their quest for enlightenment, and there are many interpretations, denominations, and sects of Buddhism, all that's really required is a Buddha heart. A Buddha heart, or Buddha nature, is simply an acknowledgement of the suffering of the world, enacting whatever way possible for the individual to end it. You need not be a Buddhist to have Buddha nature. You only must live with compassion for other sentient beings and try to alleviate suffering when possible. Buddhism is big on lists. One could study the lists of precepts for years. There's a boatload of literature out there where one can deep dive into them. For the purpose of this chat, we should concern ourselves with what, to me, are the two most important. The Four Noble Truths. The truth of suffering, the truth of the cause of suffering, the truth of the end of suffering, and the truth of the path that leads to the end of suffering. The first truth is obvious. We see suffering all around us, on the news, on the streets, and for most of us, in our own hearts. Victims of war, gun violence, the poor and the homeless, our LGBTQ plus neighbors living in fear. This is all suffering that we witness every day. The truth of suffering is that it not only exists, but it's becoming more prevalent. The second truth, the cause of suffering, can get a little complicated here. Determining the cause of suffering can be as subjective and varied as individual human beings. I think most of us have opinions as to the cause of suffering. War, gun violence, poverty, environmental collapse, and the crimes of capitalism are on the top of my list. Racism and repression of our LGBTQ neighbors, I don't know why I keep tripping over that, also figures prominently. The third truth, the truth of the end of suffering, it's a tenet of Buddhism that suffering isn't necessarily an inevitable aspect of the human condition. And to end suffering is possible. Otherwise, why go on trying to alleviate it? This is central to Buddhism. Living in such a way as to not increase suffering of sentient beings and, if possible, end it. End suffering? That, admittedly, is an awful tall order. We do what we can. The theory is that the more that we end suffering of others, the more we end suffering of ourselves. It may or may not be possible to end all suffering. This is an aspiration to strive for, even though it may never happen. The fourth noble truth is the truth of the path that leads to the end of suffering. We can adjust our behavior and lifestyles in such a way to reduce suffering. What we do, what we say, what we eat, and how we think all affects the suffering of the world. Buddhism has codified this in the second of the two most important lists, the Eightfold Path of Buddhism. Right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, right concentration. These precepts are as close as Buddhism comes to having commandments. Although there are many Buddhists that look at these as commandments and can get pretty self-righteous about it, Buddhism doesn't really have taboos. The fires of hell do not await any who forsake the precepts. The precepts would be better described as warnings. To stray from the Eightfold Path is to invite suffering. There are also common sense guidelines for keeping peace in the village, that is, living in community. These are concepts found in many spiritual creeds and are not unique to Buddhism. Although there are many variations of Buddhism, Siddhartha never discussed the afterlife. He always insisted that he was a mortal man with no insights in what happens when we die. Although the concept of heaven and hell exists in some Buddhist discourse, it's usually the result of our own actions that we find ourselves in one or the other, and it's something we experience while still living. The promise of paradise is not involved in traveling the Eightfold Path. It's just a path to the end of suffering. It's rather inconvenient to know that living the Eightfold Path is up to the individual. There are a lot of people who would gladly express their opinions as to what that is, but when the rubber meets the road, we make our own decisions about how we live with compassion, and it's up to us what to describe the cause of sufferings are. In our own consciousness, and how we definitely choose to end it. This often involves an uncomfortable level of individual thought. For each of us, the Eightfold Path is what we say it is. There's a global movement of what is generically known as engaged Buddhism. Engaged Buddhism is a political and environmental activism guided by the principles of the Dharma, or Buddhist teachings. Activists who try and end global suffering. Organizations like the Buddhist Peace Fellowship are active in resistance struggles combating racism, war, climate change, white supremacy, and more. This is a nonviolent movement dedicated to ending the suffering of the indigenous and people of color all over the world, ending war, and restoring a healthy planetary environment through living the Eightfold Path. Buddhism is not new to political activism. British colonial rule in Burma, present-day Myanmar, was opposed by Buddhist monks. I highly recommend George Orwell's essay, Shooting an Elephant. In the early 60s, many Buddhist monks and priests protested the brutal Diem regime in South Vietnam. A few even immolated themselves in public to draw attention to the plight of the poor. You don't have to identify as a Buddhist to live the Eightfold Path. I invite you to reflect on times where you might have done something that isn't in lockstep with your core beliefs, maybe while making a living. We make personal choices, and it's within our own hearts and minds that we live or not live the Eightfold Path. When I was in my early 20s, I worked at the Chevron refinery in Richmond, California. I was a security officer. I had concerns for my health and safety, being exposed to the varied chemical hazards in the plant, and fires and spills were common. Although actual Chevron employees were treated well, the real dirty work was done by contractors, many of which were from the adjoining neighborhoods, poor people of color with few economic prospects. The people in fence-line communities bear the brunt of environmental degradation. The poor are always the first to suffer as a result of humanity's ill. Part of my job was keeping an eye on them, enforcing rules, and preventing theft. I didn't win any popularity contests amongst the workers, and I came to hate it. But I was young, married, had a baby on the way. I did what I did with a feeling of entrapment. I had responsibilities. This was a cause of suffering. Although I wasn't a practicing Buddhist at the time, I came to realize that I had deviated from the Eightfold Path. I didn't think of it in those terms, but I knew my life was not heading in the direction I wanted on many levels. On reflection, I knew that right thought, right effort, and right livelihood were just not happening. My evolution had begun. Needless to say, I managed to extricate myself from that unhealthy situation, and eventually I became an activist, resisting some of Chevron's more egregious activities. I can't say that my contribution was earth-shaking, and I certainly didn't keep Chevron's management up at night, but I felt much better about myself. That was part of the path that leads to the end of suffering. It may not always be lucrative, adhering to your own moral code, but it's much healthier. You may be an engaged Buddhist and not even know it, or think of yourself that way. You may not know the Dharma from a donut, but when you are true to your own moral code, you are enlightened. Any action you take with the consciousness of the greater good is engaged Buddhism. When you help a neighbor that's in need, that's engaged Buddhism. When you speak truth to power, that's engaged Buddhism. The warm feeling you get when you help a total stranger is engaged Buddhism. The satisfaction derived from standing up for something you believe in, the release that is shouting at the top of your lungs in protest, the simple joy of serving a plate of food to someone you love or to someone that is hungry. The activities that we as Unitarians pride ourselves on, these are all way stations on the Eightfold Path and our engaged Buddhism. One of the toughest aspects of activism is to retain the joy of enlightenment, to stand up for what you believe in a place of love. I'm not saying to avoid passion, anger, or even rage, but I implore you to remember your code. Remember who you are and what you're about. To approach resistance from a place of love, not hate. Goals are good, but know that life is a journey that continues no matter what is achieved or not achieved. Find joy in the journey and do not obsess on the destination. All sentient beings are connected. Hatred pollutes and love purifies. Our culture preaches independence and productivity, but in the end, we're social animals and we need each other. When we live the path, when we strive to end our own suffering, we help end the suffering of others. Some years ago, I was talking to an old Army buddy who was going through a very nasty divorce. Anger is much more corrosive to the vessel in which it is carried than to the object on which it is poured, he mused. Well, Mike, that's very profound, I said, deeply impressed. Dear Abby, he said flatly. Oh, I felt some disappointment. No matter the source, the adage is quite true. Anger can be a useful tool, but it can also cause great suffering. The work of resistance is a long haul, and we may never see the results that we desire. This is where the Eightfold Path is of great value, even if you don't identify as any sort of Buddhist. Right thought, right action, and the others can keep you whole. You can be true to your own essence. We live in challenging times, and there's work to do for people of conscience. However, we must strive not to become our own enemy. Hate is counterproductive, and in the long run, with unmanaged hatred, we only destroy ourselves, and then we're lost. We must act from a place of love, and we must work with a sense of compassion. We must be kind whenever possible. Living these precepts is not only a favor to the planet and our community, they are survival skills for ourselves. Live gently, gently, and refuse to burn out. Friends, I invite you to place your hands over your heart. I would like to share with you as a closing blessing the words of Thich Nhat Hanh, a great Zen teacher. Morning of peace. Treading the path that leads to the moon, I look back and can't stop marveling. I see a bubble of water on the immense ocean of space. It's the Earth, our green planet. Her sumptuous beauty, sparkling and proud. Walking mindfully on the earth, a grassy path, my feet make the promise to embrace the early morning and touch the peace of the present moment. Autumn leaves fall and cover the path. Unrolling a carpet of walking meditation, a shy squirrel hiding behind an oak tree looks at me, surprised. Then dashes to the top of the tree and disappears behind a cluster of leaves. I see a clear stream flowing between the rocks, its water laughing while trees whistle. Together, we celebrate a morning of peace. At the same time, I see deep suffering, where men imprison men and make each other suffer. The waves of discrimination, hatred, and greed, inevitable causes of catastrophe, crash upon the earth. Chicks of the same hen wear different colors in order to fight with each other. Heart-rending cries declare the horrors of war. Brothers and sisters, the beautiful earth is us. I embrace her, hold her tenderly against my chest, breathing together in the same rhythm. We restore our calm, our peace. Let us accept one another. Let us share and make it possible for great love to arise. We extinguish the flame of our chalice, but not our hope for the future, our courage in the face of crisis, and love we share with all the world. Blessed are we. Go in peace.
Thank you.